Hey, what's going on, everybody? Gareth here, FCP Euro. Welcome back to another DIY video. We have a pretty simple one here for you today. As you can see, I have an intercooler sitting here on the workbench, and we're going to be installing this in an F30 335. So we have CSF's high-performance intercooler. This is specifically for the F30 platform, so it actually fit F22 cars, F30, F32, F33, F34, F36, N20 and N55 cars alike. The biggest thing here is if you have one of these cars and it's tuned, you've probably already started to experience some level of heat soak. Even the factory cars will do that to a degree. It'll pull timing back, and that's because the factory intercooler is pretty small. CSF has done a pretty good job in making a larger core and increasing the surface area, which on an air-to-air intercooler is extremely important to properly exchange heat. This is a very simple bolt-on upgrade that you can do on, like I said, a stock car or even a tuned car. If you are tuned, we highly recommend looking at this option. And later on in this video, once we pull the stock intercooler out, you're going to see the size difference. We'll also do a weight comparison between the two. But with that said, let's talk about some of the tools you're going to need to do this job, and then we'll go ahead and jump right into it. All right, so some of the basic tools you need for the job. I have a quarter-inch impact gun just because there's a ton of self-tapping screws that hold the splash shields on and a bunch of other components on this car. 8mm and 10mm are going to be most of those sizes, along with a T25 torque socket, extensions, flathead screwdriver, Phillips head screwdriver. If you want a pair of hen clamp pliers, you could use those as well. Once we get to that point in the video, we'll talk about what that is and why it might be necessary. Optionally, CSF includes this stencil for the intercooler. So if you're about the show, you want some black spray paint to go along with that. But if you're about the go, let's be honest, no one's going to be able to see this logo because you just took your opponent to Gabblebee's. So you're going to need those in this case. So with that said, let's go ahead and hop into the job. We'll show you how to get this done. So if you're new to working on BMWs and you need to get access to the engine bay from underneath, 8mm screws, lots of them. In this case, I have an 8mm flip socket on a magnetic extension on a quarter-inch impact gun. This is probably one of the most useful tools you can have in your toolbox if you're working on BMWs. If you have worked on BMWs before, you probably already have this stuff, so I didn't tell you anything you already didn't know. But there's a lot of screws. I'm not going to count them. I'm going to start from the back, work my way to the front. So now we lower the car back down. We have to remove the radiator fan because that kind of holds the entire cooling core together. This car has an aftermarket intake on it, but this process is not really any different whether you're removing the factory intake or an aftermarket intake. It's held on with a hose clamp here. We'll pull this whole assembly out of the way, disconnect the mass airflow sensor. That'll give us access to start removing the radiator fan. And then we'll disconnect the mass airflow sensor. I was just using the flathead screwdriver to push down the lock tab just to get a little bit of extra leverage. And there's just one 10mm nut in the rear here, just holding the heat shield in place. Not very tight. And an 8mm screw I didn't see either. There we go, success. And now that we've removed those hidden fasteners, we go ahead and pull the intake out. I'm gonna hold it over here on the inlet to the turbo. I don't wanna break this piece. Okay, there we go. So now that the intake's out of the way, we can go ahead and start removing the fan. On this car, you have one little lock here on the left side of the vehicle. I'll go ahead and push that tab in, start lifting. So you can see it just started sliding up. I want to keep this in a position where it keeps that lock in place. Now I'm going to come over here to the right side. I'm going to start working on disconnecting the electrical connector of the fan. So my goal here is to pull the fan up slowly, make sure it doesn't get caught in anything on the way up. Once I have it up high enough, I'll be able to reach that electrical connector. So now that I'm in this position, I'll reach down. There's two tabs on the side. I'll just depress those and I should be able to just pull the connector off. Again, this could be stubborn because they are weather sealed. Actually, that one came out really easily. These are the releases I was talking about. A little wrestling match to get that out. I just have to make sure that this clears the upper radiator hose on the left side. So once I had that clear, I was able to angle it and wiggle it out, while also making sure that our inlet pipe for the turbo isn't being pulled on too hard. So next up, we have this duct that pretty much forces air to the intercooler. It's clipped in place to the radiator core support. So I'm just taking a flathead screwdriver and I'm prying it out of the way. Technically, I think you can get away without doing this, but I just want it out of the way. So this is just like a little grommet or seal that kind of holds it all together. So the charge pipes on these cars are held on with these hen clamps, H-E-N-N. Now there's a special tool for them. However, I found on these cars, that hen clamp removal tool has some limitations. So I actually just use a flathead screwdriver and an angled pick, and I pull it down so it comes into a locked position. The key on this is you need to pull it evenly, and you have to like kind of push it out of the lock. So once you kind of like slide it out of the lock, I then like to bring it down into the locked position. You can kind of see up here, it's gonna wanna sit in a specific spot. So we can do that. One thing I did notice is that the charge pipe is already coming off, which is nice, because they can sometimes be pretty stubborn. The intake side has an aftermarket charge pipe on it. So if you have a stock charge pipe, this is gonna look a little bit different, but it's still connected to the intercooler with a hen clamp. And again, we'll provide a link to the tool if you want to get the specific one. But like I said, I found that on these charge pipes, that specific tool is kind of a pain. There we go. Okay. Let's just confirm. Wow. They never come off that easily. So we'll call that a blessing. And I'm gonna go ahead and do it here on the intake side. And that's gonna be the one that fights us. There we go. Slid off. Our intercooler is secured with two T25 Torx screws. So go ahead and remove that now. And these are just self-tapping plastic screws. Now we can go ahead and pull our intercooler out, let it drop down, kind of in the way. We'll obviously be more careful putting the new one in, but that is our stock intercooler out in all its glory, or lack thereof, really. So we're gonna get an actual scientific measurement here, like with a scale. But just to put this in comparison, I can lift the old intercooler up with a thumb and two fingers, and the CSF, I kind of have to cradle with my whole arm, and I'm getting kind of tired holding it like this. So let's find a scale. Let's weigh this thing real quick. Stock intercooler, 6.4 pounds. This has to be at least 20.
Has to be. I would say 25.
Ooh, right in the middle. Almost dead in the middle. 22 and a half. Yeah, there's a lot more material in the CSF intercooler, but we already knew that. Clearly large size difference and all aluminum versus aluminum core with plastic end tanks. So, yeah, this'll do something. So we have the CSF intercooler in place. It's loosely installed right now. We have seen some people where they pull the front bumper cover off. I think if you're at home and you're in the driveway and you can't get the car up in the air, that is a safe option for you potentially, but you don't have to pull the bumper cover off. Now this is an X-Drive car and the front subframe is a little bit of an odd shape, so this is actually the tightest it will ever be for you. What I did to get a little bit of extra wiggle room is I disconnected the AC hose here from the subframe, and then from there I was able to kind of angle it up in, as you saw. A lot of the pieces that would normally be attached to the stock intercooler are not going to work for this. So you don't have to worry about like those ceiling brackets or anything like that. But now that it's up in location, the biggest thing is went ahead and installed some of the new hardware just to kind of loosely keep it in place. As you saw, there's a significant weight difference here, so I would not balance that and connect the charge pipes at the same time, and I wouldn't let this hang by the charge pipes. So it's really just better that you get it installed and hanging off the radiator support or the core support before you try to install the charge pipes. But now that it's in position, we can go ahead and install the charge pipes. We'll go ahead and get those on, and then we can go ahead and button everything up. Really important to make sure that it is seated properly. There is going to be a little bit of wiggle. It's not going to be like rigidly mounted. If it was rigidly mounted, it would definitely break. So a little bit of wiggle is fine. As long as the clamp locks down, you're good, which that did. And now I'll come over here to the cold side. And this was the hardware that was loosely installed. You have to use a big washer, which they include, just because the way that this mounts into position is different than the factory intercooler. Dude, this car had to be apart before. So next up, we're gonna go ahead and put our radiator fan back in place. And like I said, you have your inlet here to the turbo. You wanna be careful with that. And before we get too far, we'll go ahead and plug the electrical connector back in. It can only go in one way. It's keyed, so can't plug it in backwards. And now we just wrestle some more. Again, the biggest struggle going back in is dealing with the inlet for the turbo. One thing I didn't mention when I pulled the radiator fan out is that there actually is a T25 screw that secures the fan shroud to the radiator core support. In this car's case, it was missing entirely, and it finally occurred to me that it was missing, but in our benefit here, because the CSF intercooler came with new mounting hardware, we'll go ahead and take that T25 from down below and use it up here because it's basically the same screw. So, actually worked out in our favor. And since a couple of the mounting tabs that would normally be available on the stock intercooler are not on the CSF intercooler, I'd like to have one more mechanical connection holding it in place. It's not really a big deal. It's not going anywhere, but you know. And then we're just gonna go ahead and push these little securing tabs back into place. And this will hold the wiring for the fan the way that it should have been. And to be honest with you, I don't think that those were secured either. Now that the radiator fan is back in place, we can go ahead and reinstall the intake. Again, it's an aftermarket intake on this car, so it's not gonna be 100% the same as if it was a stock intake, but generally the connections are gonna be the same. Plug in the mass airflow sensor, make sure everything is secured properly, and the hose clamp for the inlet pipe is tightened down. The last thing you want is a vacuum leak on your intake. It will run lean and probably misfire, and you're gonna hate your life if that happens, so take your time, do it right now. We'll go ahead and seat the intake pipe. It kind of just clicked into place, and then we'll go ahead and drop the heat shielding portion onto its mounts. We'll go ahead and plug in our mass airflow sensor before we forget. One thing I'm gonna do off camera is I don't really like how this is just sitting on the end of this barb. I'm gonna go ahead and see if I can clamp that down. Sorry, it's not the greatest thing I've ever seen, but this is how the car came. Tighten down our hose clamp. Reinstall the 8mm and the 10mm fasteners, and then we're done up top. Now that everything is buttoned up at the top, I'm gonna go ahead and raise it back up, put the splash shield back underneath, and then we're done. All right, so now that everything is buttoned up at the top end, we'll go ahead and put our fabric splash shield back underneath. And remember, this is the thing that's held on by a whole ton of 8mm screws, so as long as you don't have any left over at the end, you know you did it right. I like to get a couple of screws just sort of started. And once it's supporting itself and not flopping around everywhere, then you can go ahead and reinstall the screws as you see fit. Whether you wanna go around a pattern or just do it randomly, it's up to you, it's your world. Do with it what you want. Always do a hardware check. I'm not worried about that one, that held the old intercooler in place, so that's fine. But yeah, all the screws are back on, splash shield is reinstalled, and we're ready to rock. And actually, probably just go ahead and grab one self-tapper, because it is missing. And that always kind of irks me when they're missing, so we'll go ahead and replace that. But other than that, install is done. You didn't have to pull the front bumper cover. It's ready to go. So that's how you install a CSF intercooler on an F30 335. Like I said in the beginning, this is gonna be a similar process for the F22 and F23-2 series. Obviously F30 and F31-3 series, the F32, F33-4 series coupe and convertible, as well as the F34 Grand Touring GT. Yep, F34 GT, 3 series GT. And of course the F36 4 series Grand Coupe. It's a lot of chassis codes, remember. Whether it's a N24 cylinder or an N55 6 cylinder, it's gonna be the same process. Carbing X drive or rear wheel drive, that is going to change the front subframe, which could change the clearancing. But like we showed you on this X drive car, it is totally possible to install the intercooler out pulling the front bumper cover off. As long as you get the front of the car high enough in the air, you have more than enough room to get it in and out. The only other thing I would recommend on these cars is if it is a higher mileage vehicle, you might want to have the charge pipes on hand just in case, particularly on the cold side, because that is a very brittle part with age. So just kind of be prepared for that. If you're installing an aftermarket charge pipe at that time, that's fine too, but it doesn't hurt to have those parts on hand just in case the plastic decides to break on you. I've been there, it's not fun, so just be prepared. But also, if you were installing a stock intercooler, it's gonna be the same process. In this case, this car needed the upgrade being tuned, and we probably will no longer see any kind of limp conditions due to heat soak. So hope you learned something in this video. If you have any questions or comments, leave in the comment box below. Hit that like button if you like this video, and hit the subscribe button. We have a lot more videos on the way. As always, we'll see you for the next one. Thanks for watching.